Hey, it's Warren Hewitt here. Hope you're doing marvelously well. We're here at Summer NAMM in Nashville. Sorry, my old friend from Nashville used to call it that. So anyway, I love it here already. We've only been here about 15 minutes. I've been stopped like four or five times, which is fantastic. You guys rock. And this is so different to the winter NAMM. It's so much more mellow. And that doesn't mean there's not many people here. It's actually really packed. But there's a lot of all age groups. We're just talking to 3 17-year-old kids in a band. There's a lot of families here. I like it already. Plus, the thing that's gonna be very exciting for me is there's tons and tons of guitar stuff. Because it's Nashville, it's the home of music, it's all about playing. So there's a lot of guitar. Everywhere I look around, I see guitars and pedals and amps and stuff. So I'm gonna have some fun by playing lots of guitars. We're going to do walk around. You'll see some stuff in the background. It's going to be a lot of fun. A lot of looser than some of our other ones. We're just going to pick it up as we go. So enjoy it. Hello there. I hope you're doing marvelously well. I'm sitting here with the great Matt Rossblank. How are you, mate?
I'm great, Warren. How are you?
I'm good. I'll say our mutual friend Barry's the one that first told me about you. Yeah, Barry over at Radar was like, you have to talk to you. And then we talked on the phone.
We did, yeah, a couple of times.
A couple of times, which is a lot of fun. And now you're working with Dave.
I do a lot. Yeah, I'm independent, but I work a lot with Dave Cobb.
So you're working on your own. You're working with Dave. You're like a busy man.
I love being busy.
And are you just, this is not a Radar ad, but are you using Radar a lot? What's your tell me about that.
Well, I've been a Radar. I was the head engineer at Sun Studio in Memphis for a long time. And that's where I first got a Radar. And I left a couple years, about a year, 2 years ago to be independent. And I still base myself out of Memphis, but I've worked in Nashville a lot with Dave and other producers and engineers. And I bought the Radar from Sun because they weren't going to use it. So I really wanted to keep it. And so I just now upgraded to Radar Studio. So anything I produce or most stuff I engineer, I use the Radar on.
Are you using the touchscreen yet?
No, I don't use the touchscreen. Me and touchscreens don't get along. So I always hit the wrong button and stuff. So I'm always... I love the session controller.
Sure.
So
you're using it like a big tape player.
Yeah, I mostly stay in Radar mode.
So you stay in the whole Radar mode?
I usually track everything to tape, and I'll do a direct dump afterwards to Radar.
I see.
And sometimes I'll compare this. I'll record the sync side too, and I'll compare. But I always skip the patch bay. I skip the console. I'll plug the Radar right in the back of the tape machine, the shortest cable run I can.
Right.
I have a little D-sub, like 2 foot. I like to stay as close to it as I can. And I'll compare, like I just did a record, we compared the sync side, sounded a little bit better than the repro side, actually, for this particular thing. It was kind of like a burnt background. It was just something about the high end was different, so we kept that.
Right.
But most times, it's the repro of the take through the Radar. And I'll stay in Radar mode, and then depending, I'm not a big overdub guy, but if we do some overdubs, I might put in a Radar Studio and overdub from there.
Right.
But typically, I stay in Radar mode 90% of the time.
Wonderful. What projects are you working on the month?
Well, I just finished a great record I was producing on this girl, Emily Barker, from Australia. It came out really great. I'm finishing a record with Dave on this kid, Anderson East, coming up. I just actually finished mixing Elvis Presley. I did about 20 songs that haven't been released yet for Sony.
Wow.
And it'll be out in August, and that was amazing. I did that through the Radar, but it was stuff he cut in Memphis in the Jungle Room in 76.
Fantastic.
And the TCB band actually came and hung out while I mixed, which is equally amazing and scary to have James Burton over your shoulder while you're mixing.
I've worked with James Burton.
While you're mixing. So I have too. And so he's phenomenal. And he's a sweetheart. But so that was really amazing to get to work with the King.
On Elvis with James in the room?
Yeah. James and Norbert Putnam and David Briggs, Ronnie Tutt, and then Sam Phillips' son, Jerry Phillips, was there.
Wow.
So that was pretty cool to have. Whole
James has the best ear of any musician I've ever worked with.
Yeah,
He came and played on a country record that I did 15 years ago.
Yeah.
And he comes in, and first of all, I've never had such a clean guitar sound.
Oh, yeah.
He went over to my little Fender amp and put it on less than one.
Yeah. And he plays eights.
Yeah.
The tiniest string known to man.
Such a light touch. Beautiful.
Hey, I worked with him a couple times at Sun, and I'm a guitar player, by no means anywhere close to James. And
nobody is.
Once I got the level set, I found myself like not even near the speakers on the console. I was just watching him play, and he was playing, and he looked over and saw me staring at his fingers, and he smiled, and then he like winked, and he did something even cooler. Like he just and it was equally cool and tasteful at the same time, but he just knows how to just do a song.
I tell this story all the time. So the first time I worked with him, we put up the song on the console, and he just says, you know, start the song rolling. So I start the song rolling, just in case I go into record. So of course I go into record, and you know, he just starts picking along with the song. Yeah. Never heard it before. Comes up to the solo section, and he plays the chorus melody back that he's only heard in chorus one and chorus two.
Wow.
Plays it back in the solo, and then embellishes it, then finishes the song and turns to me and says, can I have a chord chart? And I'm thinking, why do you need a chord chart? I work with great players, and I have a good ear too, but that's a great musician. The guy just picks up everything,
Burton
melody.
He's just so tasteful.
So tasteful.
So I love Jeff, and the sweetest human being.
Yeah.
One of the sweetest guys. Does a lot of charity work and stuff. I mean, Yeah, he does amazing stuff.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
Yeah.
So you're working on The King. What songs?
We did like For the Heart, Danny Boy. All this stuff was cut in about 3 days in 1976. He got tired of going to Nashville to record, because he had to record RCA Studios, right? So he's the king, he can have whatever he wants. So he demanded that they do the record at Graceland. So they bought an old bread truck, they turned it into a mobile recording studio. Driving down to Memphis is about 3 hours. It broke down halfway through. They had to tow it to Memphis. They recorded in the jungle room, all in the jungle room, for a couple days, and got a bunch of songs done, and then they left the truck there. The truck stayed there until after he died. I don't know what happened to it. We actually, because of this session, we've been trying to research and find out.
Find out gear in it and everything?
I'm not sure what gear was in it.
Yeah.
But the stuff sounded incredible.
How many tracks?
It was 16, 2-inch 16.
Nice.
And then they took the tracks actually to Nashville, to Studio A, and overdubbed strings and background vocals and a bunch of, a lot of unnecessary stuff. And so I got to mix so the 24-track stuff was released. I mixed the alternate takes and outtakes of the same tracks with the 16-track stuff. So before the strings, before the
overdubs. Nice.
And it's really cool because it's real swampy. It's just the band and some background singers and Elvis.
Nice.
And of course, there's a lot of great stuff you'll never get to hear of what Elvis says in between the takes. But we kept a lot of that in. But
the things that you were allowed to
hear. Yeah, but I mean, that was that 76, that's right before he passed away.
Wow.
And just still, what a talent. His voice sounded great. I mean, he was just still a presence, you know, just a complete presence. So it was for me, obviously, I'm from Memphis. I worked at Sun. I'm a big music history guy.
Sure, I'm with you.
And so to get to work on the King was pretty mind-boggling. So.
Who did his original demos at Sun.
Yeah, and we, his first five releases were on Sun. I think some of that was his best stuff.
Yeah,
but this stuff was cool. We mixed all analog, Out of the Radar. They brought down, they transferred it in New York, brought me the tapes. Or the digital hard drive. We played it back from Radar. It sounded killer out of Radar.
Great.
I mixed on the board. I mixed with
what console? Real.
They have a DDA console at Philips.
Wow, and DDA. I know that from England.
Yeah, and
so many studios.
It just got completely recapped and refixed earlier this year, and it blew me away how clean it was. Because I like to get all my sounds through I brought my Spectrasonics equipment.
Cool.
We were talking about that earlier, but but we used all real tape delays. I have four plates at Philips, and there's three echo chambers.
Wow.
So I use there's no plugins were harmed in the making of this, except maybe like the flip the phase or something silly, you know?
Right.
So it was great.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it was a blast.
I can't believe you have a DDA, because that was so common when I was a kid in England.
Yeah.
Like, so many of the London studios had DDA consoles.
Yeah, they've gone through a variety of consoles, but that one's been there the longest in Studio A. So. I bring my Spectrasonics gear and I use all that, but mixing through it, monitoring through it, it's fine. It's great.
Yeah.
So.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, man, it's great.
So what did you mix to?
Well, I always try a couple of different things. So I tried the two-track, there's a Studer A80, we tried the MCI two-track, and I tried just going back into Radar, and going back in the Radar felt the best. So, you know, I print a lot of stuff back to tape, but this, didn't feel necessary this time. I got a lot of mojo out of the compressors and stuff. So.
Compressors in the original recording.
Yeah, I went through some old Poltex, and I had the old Spectrasonics two compressors. I went through the mix bus. And,
I can't imagine what it would be like soloing Elvis's voice.
It's wild. And hearing him mess up and joke and really direct the band. I mean, he was really in charge of the band, you know, and hearing them kick them in the gear. And, you know, you hear him without when you hear those guys in the studio, that's them with the wall down, the walls down, you know. So you're really hearing Elvis. Yeah. Instead of hearing him talk to Hines, he's really just talking to his friends and stuff.
Yeah.
And he's in Graceland, so his family's there, you know, and stuff. So it's, and we kept a lot of that. A lot, you'll hear that on the, so this disc one, it'll be out in August. Disc one is all the original masters from the Graceland sessions. And disc two is all the alternate stuff that I mixed, about 20 tracks. And there's all takes, alternate takes, there's half takes. You can hear him talking to me. You can hear him getting on to them when they're getting lazy and stuff. It's great. It's great. And when, of course, I took all the guys out for drinks that night and plied them with, you know, alcohol for...
To find out any more stories.
Oh, yeah. I heard some great stuff, so...
What did you find out?
Well, I'll tell you one. Probably shouldn't tell this one, but David Briggs, who... Glenn Hardin played most of the piano, and David Briggs did, like, Whirly or Clav or Rhodes. But Danny Boy, Briggs played piano. And I was asking about it, and he said, well, Glenn was having trouble with it. And David said he was done for the night. He was in the kitchen drinking, and he had quite about many drinks. About 2 in the morning, Elvis comes and says, you're going to play Danny Boy. I want you to play Danny Boy. Briggs is like, man, I can't play. I'm drunk. And Elvis said, I don't care. Get in there. And so they played Danny Boy. And he said he played it with one hand. He was so drunk he had to hold himself up to the piano with the other hand. So if you listen to Danny Boy, it's one hand on the piano the whole time. And that blew my mind because it's beautiful. Whatever he's doing is beautiful. But according to Briggs, he was hammered. So, I'll probably get in trouble for telling that one.
No, I think he'll like it.
Yeah.
It shows that he's that talented, he can do it with one hand drunk.
Exactly. So.
Well, thanks ever so much.
I really appreciate it. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
So,
thank you. That was really awesome. As ever, subscribe, leave a bunch of questions below. I'll hit him up with questions.
Yeah.
I'm here at PRA Audio. Yeah. How are you, mate? I don't know your name. Mark.
Doing great. I'm Mark Krikorian.
Mark. Good name. That's Armenian, if ever I heard
one.
Absolutely. I have a lot of Armenian friends. I work with a band called Visa.
Oh, yeah? And are you UK-based?
Yeah, but I live in Laurel Canyon in Los Angeles.
Okay, a lot of Armenians there.
Oh, tons. And I produce this band called Visa, and they're like an Armenian rock band.
Awesome.
And they have an oud player.
A what?
Oud.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he plays oud, so it's like fretless, quarter tone.
Very cool.
Oh, it's super, it's awesome.
I wouldn't be able to touch that thing, I'm sure of that.
It's amazing. All Armenian musicians know every Armenian musician.
Well,
it's super tight community. Like
Armenians are that way. We hunt each other down because there's so few.
Yeah, not in LA.
Yeah.
Like in Glendale, it's completely.
We're based in Atlanta, so, you know, you can't find an Armenian restaurant. You can barely find a Middle Eastern restaurant.
Right.
Greek
is about as good as you get.
Yeah,
right? So you basically live on Greek food.
Yeah, but my house is about as good as it gets. So.
Oh, right. Is your wife Armenian as well?
No, but she learned how to cook from my grandmother, and she does a great job.
Okay, good job. Wonderful. So the reason why we stopped is they have a really cool product. Tell us about this really cool product.
Okay, so this is a wireless for guitar and other stringed instruments. The issue for our company is we're about wireless for people who really don't like wireless. Most people have had problems with wireless mainly because the tone is not what they're used to in a cave.
Sure.
So we're crazy about tone. Right. We've developed a wireless that is flat from 2 hertz all the way to 22 kilohertz, which means it sounds good with any instrument.
Right.
We also really are focused on the ease of use. So it's so easy to use. To turn it on, when you turn it off, they immediately find each other and pair. Blue light's solid means they're paired up. But they also find their own open space for their radio in case there's other devices in the space. No channel switching or anything like that.
Smart.
Also, a lot of people complain about wireless for having proprietary connectors. And they'll break, and there's no air to get them if you don't have a replacement cable. These use a standard quarter-inch cable, so if something goes wrong, you just change a different camera. I mean, different cable. Also, pairing is super easy. You just hit one button, then the other, and they pair.
Right.
So if you want to switch guitars or something like that, it's very, very easy to do.
Oh, awesome.
Also, we make another version of it that's for doing recording into your computer. So you go USB directly into your computer and go into GarageBand, IK Multimedia. That's this over here. So it's got a USB dongle.
Nice.
Works with any computer and also even with iPads and Androids. So you can go into GarageBand on your iPad and lot of people on the road would love to be able to, you know, practice or or do cutting.
This is really cool.
Yeah.
And it's made in the USA.
Everything we do is made in the USA, yeah.
And how much is this pair?
This is $299.95.
So that's really cool.
And that's $249.95.
And so it comes with this and one of these.
Comes with this and one of these. Also, let me see. We got something in there. Also comes with a holster, the charging cables, and the quarter inch jack.
Oh, wonderful.
So this goes inside of there.
So you just clip that on.
Yep.
Great.
And it's got it's a very durable holster with turns and everything like that.
Yeah, it's a good idea because I know with this I'm always that's great, smart.
Yeah, we have a lot of other products in the pipeline that are going to be coming out soon.
Yeah,
as well.
What are these pedals you got down here?
Those are overdrive pedals.
Can I see?
So this is a new product. Yeah.
I'm a guitar player as well. So.
Yeah. Okay. That one is actually connected into the overdrive pedal right now, I think.
It is? Okay, great.
Yeah. So those are paired up.
Nice.
Feel free to mess with the pedal. So that's a variac control.
Oh yeah. So it sounds like Jimmy Page, like late 60s.
Forget you were going wireless while you're doing that.
It is pretty crazy, yeah. I never really liked wireless. I remember the Nadies were really popular in England because they were affordable. Yeah, it's great.
Yeah,
very nice.
Very cool.
Yeah, I love products like this, revolutionary stuff. Affordable, does the job.
Yeah.
Very nice.
I think it's important to not mess with the tone. That's what we're about.
Definitely.
Thanks a bunch. We're BRA Audio, and we're in Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay, great. We'll put links and everything below.
Awesome. Thanks. I appreciate it.
So we're over here at Empirical Labs. How are you, mate?
Good to see you, Warren.
Good to see you. We met at AES. We were just talking
in New York.
About.
Yep.
So you're going to tell us about the new Arouser.
Yes. People are very excited about this. David's been working on this for a very long time.
Great.
Now, of course, people have been dying for a distressor plugin. This is the Arouser, and so he likes to be clear that it is its own thing. Now,
sure.
It does have very similar layout, very similar sound as well. As the Arouser goes, it has your basic large knobs. This is the way the distressor does.
Sure.
The same ratio settings, except they added a couple new features. The 1.5:1 ratio is new, and also Rivet is new. Well, it's actually Nuke. They just renamed it, and I think the rest are the same. And then Dave went ahead and made a attack modification, which allows you to really mess with the curve. You can actually add a lot more of a smack to drums, to snares.
To more of an SSL.
Right. And also to be able to still gain, even when something's over-compressed.
Sure.
You can still get peaks. And then you have your saturation here, your soft clipping with the knob here, which allows you to get a lot more detail as opposed to the distressor.
Yeah, I like this idea. So attack modification, working with
With the attack knob, and you can actually it's a cool little feature. Just be able to type in, you know, whatever setting you'd like to use and not have to actually deal with
it. The thing about a distressor that we always used to love is that it can pretty much, now obviously there's a lot of conjecture and discussion, but it can pretty much simulate any compressor.
Right.
I can make it feel like an 1176. I can make it feel like a 160, right, which are very opposite sounding compressors.
Right.
But they're the two main compressors I use.
Yeah.
So what I always loved about a distressor, and if somebody said, I only want to have one compressor, and they understood compressors, I'd always recommend a distressor.
Because it covers so much.
So this is a good idea. So basically it takes the same distressor ideas,
yep,
and then it adds some other stuff.
Right, yeah, and you also have your detector sidechain, and right, the other big thing is the blend mix knob. A lot of people right, are liking to be able to do that now with it as well. And Dave worked really hard, even on, it came with a whole bunch of presets that I've actually just been demoing and showing people here at NAMM, and even just the presets alone sound fantastic. You know, just going through, and then for anyone, it's very user-friendly. That's one of the things I wanted to point out too. It's very user-friendly, and they even added a little help menu for all the little details stuff here as well. And if you click the Empirical Labs site, it'll actually bring you to the site. So, you know, Dave has really laid everything out to where it's understandable, and anyone can, you know, jump into it.
Blend, I think, is really useful because it's basically, then it becomes a parallel compressor in a box.
Right.
Where you can absolutely destroy it, and then you can blend back and see. Because with me and drum parallel compression, I don't EQ separately. Some people do, they'll have a drum bus and then a parallel bus and change the EQ.
Yeah.
No matter what you do and what you use, you can always get some kind of weird phase issues. It doesn't work for me.
Okay.
So I love this idea, it's very smart.
To have that in,
that's
awesome.
Really cool. I gotta try it out.
Oh, yeah.
I like the way they call it rivet, because it's like, yes, hold it down, it's riveted. So I'm here with Tim Silvers from Richlight. He has a product that he was just telling me about. This is, you know what, I'm going to have him tell me about it, because what this is recycled paper that is heavily compressed and they're using for fingerboards. It literally feels like, I don't know how close we can get this, it looks and feels like ebony. And you know me, I'm always like on the lookout for cool and exciting stuff. And this is pretty awesome.
And if you want some cool wood grain stuff,
yeah,
through the radius, you get that through our chocolate color.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah, it's insane.
So tell us a little bit more about the process, because I'm oversimplifying.
So the process is we get recycled paper,
yeah,
and we bring it into our facility, and we have right, our own machines. You get it embedded with our product, and we cut it and press it under, I can't tell you the exact specifications, but
sure,
pressure and heat, which yeah, we make sheets of this, and it's laid up by hand.
Yeah.
And we do it by weight. So you can make anywhere from an 1/8 inch to 3 inches, from a 4x8 sheet to a 5x12 sheet.
Wow.
And we're selling international, small little company since 1943.
It's been around since 1943?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Oh,
making
wow,
this.
Beautiful.
And we can make anywhere from countertops, guitars, fret bodies, tables. Paul Allen used it to make a building in Seattle.
Wow.
It's you can do anything with our product, Richlight, that you can do with wood or steel, but welded.
So cool.
It's insane.
Yeah, it's crazy. And it's made from recycled paper.
It's recycled, it's green, American made. Yes, sir.
Beautiful, beautiful. Now, Gibson are using it?
Gibson's using it on some of their select models, the Baritone, and they use it on the Ace, some of the classic models. This is our homemade one. Feel that.
Whoa!
That is 15 pounds. Usually a body's like, what, 3.5?
Wow.
This was just to say, hey, look what we can do. But it sounds great, too. You want to plug it in?
I do. I'm intrigued.
It sounds just like a Tele should. I mean, a Strat should.
Thank you. It's great.
I mean, that's a great studio guitar because it's so heavy.
But it weighs a lot, but it's
great.
But
it sounds good though, right? And those are just stock parts. No fancy hardware, fancy pickups or anything.
It's crazy.
Very
weighs a lot.
Yeah, it's a heavy guitar.
It's like, whoa.
But like I said, we just made that for fun so we can show what we can do with it. We make, we're the leading producer of skateboard ramp material called Skate Light.
Right.
And counter, like this wall is Rich Light. That's Rich Light, that's Rich Light. This little tiny bridge on the Deering. That is this whole neck, the nut.
It's beautiful.
It's crazy.
Wow.
Sorry about that, brother.
That's quite all right. That's amazing.
It's good stuff.
Well, fantastic. Thanks for showing us it.
Well, thank you very much.
Beautiful. Hi there. I'm with Doug Fern. How are you?
Good to meet you.
Good to meet you, too. I stopped because when we were mixing some Aerosmith tracks, I was with Jack Douglas, we got one of these from Vintage Kit.
Yeah.
And we tried it out, and I believe we used it on the mix bus and on guitars. We were trying it for different songs. We were very blessed in those days because it was a high-profile act that people were lending us stuff to do, and it was really beautiful. So this is kind of a work of art. It's nice to see like really, really well-made, beautiful piece of equipment like this. So, Doug, I mean, can you tell me a little bit about your journey, how you got to make this, and right, decisions?
Well, you know, I was a studio owner for many years.
So, oh, you were?
Yeah. So, and I just realized that it's been 50 years that I've made my living from pro audio.
Yeah.
Either as a studio owner or as a manufacturer. And so obviously you have certain things that you like the way they sound.
Right.
And what I always wanted in a compressor was something that was very transparent, controlled the levels, glued the mix together, but wasn't in your face compression.
Sure.
You know? And that's how the VT7 came about. And it's not based on anything else.
Right.
It's all vacuum tubes in the audio path, the gain control elements of pulse width modulator, and it's achieved what I wanted for it. And like, you know what it sounds like.
Yeah, it sounds beautiful. I mean, it's a you know, it's a beautiful looking piece of equipment, which I love as well.
Well, and, I think something that's that sounds great should look great.
Yeah, exactly. So, did you sort of modernize tubing? Because the only thing sometimes with the old tube stuff is that the attack and release times are just never quick enough for me.
Yeah.
They're good for gentle mixed bus compression. Even now, if I go into a studio with 670, I have a tendency to just stick it last in the chain of a bus, of a guitar bus or a drum bus, and it's not there to really do much except add some color.
Right. Yeah.
So did you improve the attack and release times on these?
Yeah, I mean, like most of the products I've made, they're designed by ear.
Right.
So I found what was the range that I found usable.
Yeah.
And that's what they are.
Right.
You know, the settings that we see here right now are pretty typical for something on a mix bus.
Sure.
You know, not a real fast attack and a fairly quick release, but not super fast.
Right.
But you can go up to, you know, that much release time depending on the program material. And of course, if you want something more aggressive, you can turn that as a faster attack. But like I said, it's mainly just designed by ear for what I wanted to do.
So I see you've got fast and slow attack, fast and slow release. Now, with the harder, softer, what's that control?
It's actually, there's two separate side chains.
Yep.
And this is essentially a pan pot between the two.
I see.
So I could have just put a switch in there, there's one side chain or the other, but I found it useful to be able to mix between them. So this control affects so many different parameters. It's really hard to label because it affects the knee, the ratio, to some extent the attack and release constants and everything. So it's the kind of thing you really have to use to figure out what it
does. Yeah, I understand. I mean, that's the beauty of equipment anyway, especially tactile, where we can grab and we can move things. And it's all part of the experience. It's like we're having this ongoing discussion about vinyl. I don't think anybody believes that vinyl is better quality than digital, but there's something about the experience of vinyl. And I think that's the great thing about beautiful made equipment is, you know, sometimes when you're mixing, you just want to reach over and go, oh, it's better.
Right.
Rather than using a mouse.
Yeah.
So you've got gain reduction, an output presumably.
That's right.
And so this separated length. Well, what's the high pass setting?
Well, it's just a high pass filter in the side chain.
I see.
And, you know, for on a mixed bus, that's almost always you use that.
Right. Yeah, otherwise you're just going to, the bottom end is just going to pump your compression too much.
Right. Yeah, so it's a very gentle curve.
Right.
Maybe 150, somewhere in there.
Very, very gentle.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah, and again, that's designed by ear.
Wonderful.
Tried lots of different frequencies for that and determined
and
that.
You were a studio owner and engineer and producer.
Right. I still do recording.
Oh, you do? Great.
Yeah.
Well, I think about it, you know, what's probably one of the most famous consoles ever made is the Trident A-Range, designed by the engineers at the studio.
That's right.
And even when I have an old Kata console, and even those consoles, the engineers at the studios, at Pi Studios, told Kadak exactly what they wanted.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the BBC dictated all those frequencies that were on Neves.
Yeah.
So, not that I'm not an expert in this. I'm not an expert in anything, obviously. But, so what tubes are in this?
Each channel uses four tubes.
Four tubes, right.
And three of them are 6N1P.
Right.
Which is a dual triode Russian tube.
Right.
And the one odd one is the 6072.
Right. And what is the thinking behind that? I'm not an expert, so I'd love to know.
The 6072 has more gain.
I see.
So that's the first stage after the pulse width modulator gain control element where you need gain makeup.
Right.
And we use essentially that same topography in our equalizers as well.
Right.
I mean, the layout of the circuit, everything's the same.
I see. Beautiful.
Yep.
And it's probably got some honking great big transformers in there as well.
Well, it does, and all our products use custom-made Jensen transformers that they make for us.
I see.
And our equalizers, they make the inductors for us.
Beautiful.
Yep.
Well, thank you ever so much. I really appreciate it. I'm so glad that we got to see you, got to talk about it.
Yeah, well, I have to tell you how much I've enjoyed your videos as well.
Thank you very much.
They're very, very useful, and you're a great communicator, so thank you for doing that.
No, I really appreciate that. You know, we're just trying to sort of be in the middle between the beginner, you know, and the hobbyist up to the professional, because I feel like we're all the same.
Right.
When you're a kid or starting out, whatever age it might be, you get into it because we love music.
Right.
Especially in this day and age, nobody starts to produce and engineer music because they're like, I want a Ferrari.
Right.
You know, you have to do it because you love it.
That's right.
And so to me, it's like, it's a level playing field now. It's so great, you know.
Yeah.
Whether you've got a little two-input digital with a $79 microphone or you've got unlimited budget. It's a level play for this one. Thank you, Doug. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure, Warren. Thank you.